Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The fact they've dimmed the lights suggests to me that they probably want me to start the lecture. First of all, thank you very much for coming out on a foggy evening, which is quite cold. I appreciate you making the effort to do that. There is an administrative announcement, which is that at the end, because there's a function on in the museum, could we please leave by the back entrance? Now, the back entrance, if you turn around and look to the back of the hall, it's on your left and my right, right up there at the top, and you go through a rather wiggly passage, which helps take you out. It is actually a slightly quicker way to the pub where we normally have a drink afterwards. So it has its advantages. It doesn't seem a very long time since my last lecture. It's in fact only just over 3 weeks, I think. And as I've been travelling around the Middle and Far East for most of the intervening period, it seems actually even less time to me. Fortunately, the airline connections worked, and I got back to the UK yesterday, and I'm here. They tried to get me on a flight that would have had me landed at 3 p.m. today, and I decided that that was cutting it just slightly fine, given unreliability of transport. I hope that the provocative title hasn't misled people into thinking that I will give a detailed explanation of all Karl Marx's key views and the reasoned critique. There are so many people who can do that so much better than me that I don't think it's a good idea to waste your time in that way. I will touch on some of Karl Marx's views, but my aim today is to use them as an introduction to the real topic of the lecture, which is the impact of globalization on profit shares. And what I've argued is that the impact, well, the initial impacts of globalization has been to make businesses very much more profitable and change the trends in business profitability. Now, as a subsidiary question, I decided it was worth doing the maths and looking at some of the issues about whether exploitation is a good thing. Obviously, it's a good thing if you're a capitalist, but if you're the one being exploited, you may not actually think being exploited is a good thing. But Karl Marx is actually surprisingly realistic, and he believed that high profits led to faster economic growth. And so I've adopted a sort of Marxist savings function and modeled the evolution of wages under conditions of high exploitation and low exploitation. And actually, the good news is if you're a worker, you want to be exploited quite a lot, because you'll end up earning a lot more if you're exploited than if you exploit your capitalist too much, squeeze his profits, and stop him from investing. So exploitation can happen in two different ways. The workers can exploit the capitalists, and the capitalists can exploit the workers. I don't think Karl Marx fully appreciated that the workers could exploit the capitalists. So I will take you through that. Now, I'll start with Marx's theories and the ones that are relevant. Then I'll look at profit shares, profitability. I'll look forward over the next 20 years because I am, at heart, an economic forecaster, and giving you some glimpse as to what's likely to happen in the future does seem to be one of the values of being here. And then finally, when is exploitation good for you? And obviously that depends on who's doing the exploiting. Now, the background to all this is globalization, and these are the themes that have been running through all my lectures, except for the sort of more social ones, which I give. The seventh lecture each year is meant to be a sort of funny that I can choose a topic. It doesn't have to be part of the main theme. So I talked about transport in London last time, and next time I'm going to talk about the inverse correlation between economic prosperity and sporting success, with special reference to the Ashes series. And you'll note after the result of the Adelaide test that this chimes in perfectly, because as George Osborne pointed out last week, the UK economy has improved a lot while the Australian economy has gone downhill for the last year. And see what's happened. The cricket has responded very, very rapidly indeed. And I mean, this is all part of a much bigger theme, which is you can't really have democracy without cricket, which is a theme that I'm not going to cover in the series of Gresham lectures, but I'll give a lecture on that at some point. Right. The first thing we need to be aware about is that world economy is dealing with not only the challenge of globalization, but also with an amazing technological revolution. And it's not just the fact of the revolution, but the nature of the revolution that has implications for profits. Essentially, much of the world economy is increasingly based on information communication technologies in one of the various forms. But the very great economies of scale associated with these technologies means that profits are difficult to predict and are likely to be volatile. Indeed, it is likely that there will be oligopoly or monopoly and volatile profit schemes as oligopolistic sectors veer from being amazingly competitive with everyone reducing their prices because they want to take advantage of economies of scale, and only some, of course, are successful in getting the economies of scale. And then unsuccessful competitors go bust and the sector becomes more monopolistic, and so the profits go up for a while. So the profits are volatile, do you think? But the technological revolution has led to a substantial fall in the price of capital goods, most obviously computers. When I worked for IBM, I discovered that the official statistics suggested that the price of computers was going up. And since we at IBM at the time produced a third of all those computers produced in the UK, I thought we must somehow be contributing to the misinformation. So I set up an investigation. I eventually found that the forms got filled in by a guy whose day job was packing shelves. So, you know, it's not necessarily the job done with the people in the company with the highest IQ. And he filled in the form, and one of the forms was for a computer that got out of production 20 years ago. And when I asked him why he continued to fill it in, he just put in the price of the successor model. The fact that the successor model was about 2,000 times more powerful, it didn't matter. He said, it's only a government form. And that's interesting. And that's a salutary lesson if you ever look at government statistics, because these are the guys who fill in the form that makes the thing. Eventually, we corrected it, and we managed to turn the series around. So the price of computers now accurately is reflected in government statistics. Let me turn now to Karl Marx and his theories. It is fashionable among some to use Marxist today as a term of abuse. Indeed, one of the Daily Mail's and other parts of the right-wing press's criticisms of the Miliband family is that Ralph Miliband, David and Ed's father, whose writings I studied at university, not only allegedly hated Britain and ran over a cat with his bicycle when drunk, but was also a Marxist. And, you know, this is the sort of language invective. I want to rescue the term Marxist from being simply a term of right-wing abuse. Actually, Karl Marx, whatever the crimes committed in his name, was a very serious economic and sociological thinker, very much in the classical tradition of Adam Smith. It was Adam Smith who actually coined the phrase unproductive labour, which you may think rather astounding for someone who is a doyen of free markets. But more especially David Ricardo, the great economist of the early part of the 19th century. And Marx's economics is pretty Ricardian in its style. And I think Karl Marx actually deserves much wider study than simply by those who are committed Marxists. I think that he has a lot of useful insights which are very helpful in trying to analyse the world. And funnily enough, more appropriate, I think, in the 21st century than they were in the 20th century. Now, his theories are complex, and I cannot accurately summarise them in a few short sentences. But I think the key is that he saw the evolution of history from feudal or slave systems through capitalism towards communism. And he very much saw capitalism as an evolutionary stage. He wasn't particularly critical of capitalism. He thought it would die of its own contradictions, but he thought it was certainly an improvement on the earlier forms of activity, even if he felt that the dictatorship of the proletariat and the true communist state was an improvement, which I think is something that's been tested since. One of the things that I've always liked about Marx is that he saw profits as the heart of the capitalist system. And this is in contrast with most neoclassical economists, who tend to assume that profits get competed away to being normal, and tend not to get terribly excited about it. But, I mean, having worked at the CBI, and indeed run my own business, I think the health of capitalism as reflected in the level of profits is a vital element in any economy. And funnily enough, it was Karl Marx who was the first to write about this. And he's one of the very few economists who's actually focused heavily on profits. He believed that when profits were high, economic growth was faster. But he argued that profits were essentially exploitation, and that pressure from labour not to be exploited and competition between capitalists would eventually cause capitalism collapse of what he called its own contradictions. And this would happen through a squeeze on profits, leading to a squeeze on capital accumulation or investment, which would cause growth to slow, increasing the tension between the classes as the system lost its ability to supply the demands made on it by the workers and the capitalists. That's how he saw the crisis of capitalism. Now, my supervisor for my Marxist degree at Oxford was a man called Andrew Glynn. He was actually from the banking family of Williams and Glynn, so that's probably why he's a Marxist. And he wrote a book about the decline in profitability in the UK in the 1960s and 1970s under pressure from the trade unions, and concluded that this could be the moment when capitalism collapsed. And actually, he wasn't far wrong. Only Mrs. Thatcher, the split in the Labour Party when the SDP was formed, the distaste of the British public for trade union excesses, the emergence of new technologies in the 1980s, and the beginnings of globalisation combined to prove him wrong. But it needed an amazing coincidence of things to turn around the trend. The end of 1974, when I joined the CBI to work there, the old FT index collapsed to 150, which I think translates, it's not like for like because they're not precisely the same thing, but translates to about 60 on the FTSE. That's how low it got. And that was the impact of all sorts of things, of strikes, of lack of economic growth, of oil price hikes, etc. And, you know, the system wouldn't have survived at that level. So it is worth noting that we did get quite close to capitalism collapsing in the UK. And it needed quite a lot of favourable coincidences and, of course, the emergence of someone who is hugely important in this, Mrs. Thatcher, who couldn't have easily been predicted, I don't think. You know, she's a bit of a one-off. We've never really seen anyone like her since, to help change the trend. Looking at for a Marxist explanation of the current phase of globalisation, I've come across some interesting material from Trotskyite Mick Brooks from his In Defense of Marxism website. This is a website, by the way, that it hasn't been shut down. It still exists, but they haven't put new stuff on it because the people backed out after they described global warming as a plot to exploit the workers and argued it was all a load of nonsense. And it's interesting that the views of the person who wrote this article virtually identical to those of Nigel Lawson, who is also a bit of a climate change sceptic. And actually, most other sensible people are as well, of course. Anyway, this is what Mick Brooks said. Most workers in the United States and other rich economies did gain better wages and conditions for a time. They did it by organizing in trade unions and threatening the strike weapon. Any strike shows that when the workers stop working, nothing gets done. It's us that produce the wealth. He obviously thinks, despite the fact that he writes, that he's a worker. But now big business is trying to take back all the gains of past struggles. Why? Because they can. Because they can roam the world looking for cheap labour to exploit. Right on. Because they can sniff out and batten onto low pay pockets in rich countries. Because they can use child labour, because if they can use child labour, they will lose child labour. Because if they can use slave labour, they will lose slave labour. Well, I'm not quite so keen on that. How does all this affect workers in rich countries such as the United States? In 1973, there were nearly 1.5 million clothing and textile workers in the USA. Some of them have lost their jobs as firms in Nike pull up stakes and go where they can get away with paying workers less. While only 4% of clothing was imported into the United States in the 1960s, it's now gone up to 60%. Actually, very interesting that when I was in Shanghai earlier this year, I was told that Nike had pulled out of China because the wages were so high. So, you know, if you pull out of China because the wages are too high, that suggests you're pretty impressively in favour of cheap labour, doesn't it? But 860,000 still work in the rag trade in the United States. American bosses have responded to foreign competition in different ways. One response of textile and clothing companies in the rich countries to foreign competitors to make sure that if they pay you more than workers in Pakistan or El Salvador, they get more out of you. What are you saying, that globalization increases the ability of the capitalists to exploit the workers? Obviously, he thinks this is the bad thing. But whether or not it is a bad thing, let's check first on whether it's true or not. The first issue is what has been happening to the world's labor supply. Now, there have been two factors at work here, a demographic explosion in the emerging markets, and also a large movement of labor away from agriculture and pretty well subsistence agriculture to industry and services. Actually, there's been even a move out of sort of very low technology manufacturing and low technology services as well. So just taking the figures for movement out of agriculture understates the extent to which the world labor force has grown. As a result of the combination of these two factors, there's been a huge increase in the world's effective supply of non-agricultural labor. Now, here are the figures for 1980 and 2010. And what they show is the world's total supply of labor in the past 30 years increased by 68%. The labor force in advanced economies grew by 23%, but the emerging economies grew by 87% over the same period. But whereas in 1980, 60.8% of people in the emerging economies worked in agriculture, by 2010, this proportion had fallen to 38.5%. And in the advanced economies, the share in agriculture also fell from 14.2% to 4.7%. The big increase in agricultural productivity of the last 30 years in advanced economies is something that most people haven't paid very much attention to, at least, you know, people who aren't specialist agricultural economists. But it's actually been quite an important factor in making the West a more economically successful place. Now, if you take them together, the world's non-farm labor force has increased by 115% in the 30 years, which is a pretty decent rate of growth, 2.5% per annum. So, in effect, the worldwide capitalist system has been force-fed with industrial labor, with a supply of industrial labor. Now, the next stage is what has been happening to profits. We've established there's been an increase in the supply of labor. Now, the normal thing in economics is that it's the scarce factor that gets the reward. So if labor increases, you expect the capitalist to be rewarded. The distinguished economist Nicholas Kaldor, who is one of Harold Wilson's economic advisors and someone who I remember vaguely from my days as a postgraduate student, that he wasn't the sort of person to bother with someone who is as insignificant as me at that stage. But he summarized the statistical properties of long-term economic growth in a very influential 1957 paper in the probably most prestigious of the economic journals, the Economic Journal. He pointed out six remarkable historical constancies revealed by recent empirical investigations. And the most important of these is his assertion that the shares of national income received by labor and capital are roughly constant over long periods of time. And his broad generalizations were initially derived from US and UK data, but they were later found to be true for many other countries as well. And they came to be known as stylized facts. That's a bit like, you know, something a politician tells you. It's something that is roughly true, but not precisely so. Actually, it's probably rather more truthful than what most politicians tell you. In my previous lecture, I pointed out the occasional operation in economics of what the sophisticated call Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, which is that a factor, once it's observed, changes its behavior. But the less sophisticated people just call it Sod's Law. And in economics, it is almost invariably the case that when you start observing a variable, it behaves differently. We found this when we started targeting the money supply. The poor Bank of England, having come along with forward guidance for unemployment, they did it at the point when unemployment had remained pretty well flat. At the moment they started targeting it, it started falling rapidly. So it started to misbehave compared with the behavior that they'd expected in the past. And I think this is one of the facts of economics you just have to be aware of, that when you target a variable, it doesn't always do what you think it ought to. It changes its relationship. Now, because labor's share of income can be measured in a variety of ways, and some different studies cover different countries, I've looked at a range of different studies and taken a conclusion from each of them. And the good news is they all say the same thing. And it's relatively rare in economics that all the statistics for the same thing actually make the same point. So this is good news. My first exhibit is from the McKinsey Global Institute, and it claims a 7.1 percentage point in the labor share of income since its peak in 1975 for what they call advanced economies, which I think are the traditionally advanced ones rather than some have become advanced rather more recently. My second exhibit comes from the OECD, courtesy of The Economist, and it's 2nd of November edition. I apologize for some overlap in this lecture with the Economist article of that date. We're both interested in similar things. I started writing the lecture well before the Economist appeared. But the Economist only looks backwards, and this lecture is going to look forwards as well. So don't think that the Economist said it all. So we will actually say what it means in the future. And the OECD data shows the labor share of income edging down also since the mid-70s in a different sample of countries, South Korea, Germany, Japan, the US, and Mexico. My third exhibit comes from a very comprehensive study from the National Bureau of Economic Research in the US and shows the data for the world's four largest economies, US, China, though for a relatively short period, Japan and Germany. And it again confirms the downward movement in the labor share. And it's also interesting that the three emerging economies for which we have data in this sample, China, Mexico, and South Korea, have much lower labor shares of income than the advanced economies. By the way, this coincided with a Marxian theory that the more capitalism developed, the more combination of worker pressure and competition between capitalists would bid down profits and raise the labor share of income. And this is one of the contradictions, as you said, that eventually caused capitalism to collapse. So the data on profits, or the data on the labor share of income, to be precise, does show a sharp fall, which seems to be in different countries and has been, with the obvious cyclical variations, pretty persistent from the 70s or early 80s. And that's an interesting phenomenon. Now, so far so good. I mean, this all sort of fits in with theory. The world's labor force has grown rapidly, and development of this reserve army of labor has helped the capitalist increase his rate of exploitation. But remember where I started. There is a bit more than this going on. There is also the technology factor. Globalization has coincided with the emergence of information and computing technology, which has massively forced down the cost of capital goods, such as computers. The NBER study, which gave the data on profits for the four largest economies, is by, I need to check I get the pronunciation right, Karababunis and Neiman, and this suggests that over the period of the study, which is from the mid-70s, the cost of capital goods has fallen by 25% relative to consumer goods. And that this has made it attractive to swap labor for information and computer technology and software. Actually, if you just take that subsector of capital goods, which is computers, I would say the cost has probably dropped by something more like 75%. But the 25% is for the whole of the capital goods, which includes buildings and the sorts of machinery that doesn't change hugely in its real price. As I haven't carried... Sorry, let me... Karababunis and Niemann attribute about 5 percentage points of the fall in the labour share of income to this. And they suggest it accounts for more than half the fall. I haven't carried out my own research on this, so I can only observe, but my instinct would be to attribute relatively more of the fall to globalisation, combined with immigration in some countries, and slightly less to the information technology. But what's clear is both are important, and whether it's 50-50 or 60-40, and it's pretty subjective how you apply these things. Nevertheless, it is clear that both are big factors and driving this. Will this trend continue? Now, this is the thing, you know, this will help you decide whether you're going to get rich or not. If you're an investor, one of your interests must be whether the rise in equity values that's been associated with the falling labour share will continue. I've argued in the past that there have been two driving forces behind the strong equity markets of the last 48 years. Higher profitability and falling yields, which have led to a given level of profitability being capitalized at a higher rate. I dealt with the issue of yields in my lecture on the Chinese savings glut last year. It will take a long time to adjust the structural nature of the Chinese savings glut. This must happen eventually. And as a result, it is likely that yields will remain depressed for some time, perhaps the next 20 years, although there will obviously be cyclical fluctuations. But I suspect that at the very least, the pace of growth in profit shares will decline, and that returns on assets may even go into reverse. Now, why is this? Well, we have identified two factors which have generated this huge increase in the profit share, and they are the world's labour force and the information technology. As an ex-chief economist of IBM UK, I would say that the technology is probably going to continue, although some of the biggest gains have probably already been made, but I suspect there's still a lot more to happen there. But on the labour force side, it's clear that both the two factors that drove the growth in the labour force, which were the movement out of subsistence jobs in agriculture and the very strong demographic growth, both of those are going to be much less important as we look forward. This slide from The Economist, this one's from McKinsey, show that the demographic gain from the growth in the labour force in advanced economies has very much slowed down. And this slide, which is from the same source, shows the same thing in China. They've had the one-child per family policy, which has ended up... Last year, the Chinese labour force actually fell by 3.5 million people. That's roughly the population of Ireland. So, that shows how labour is becoming scarce, even in an economy which is still relatively low income. And that, of course, will mean that wages go up. Of course, the other impact of the demographics in China is that there's a huge surplus of males and a huge shortage of women. There are different estimates, and I think they depend how old you consider to be marriageable. But one account says there's a shortage of 100 million women in China, and one account says there's a shortage of 50 million women in China. Now, it's obviously good news if you happen to be female, but I think... Even if there are only 50 million testosterone-filled males rushing around frustrated, it will still have an effect. And it's one of the issues that the CIA is studying in great detail because they believe that it could make China more aggressive and more nationalist. They'd probably become football fans if they were Western. But being Chinese... they may find other ways of showing their frustration. So this is what's going on in China. And taking the trends together, there is a slowing down in the world's labor force growth over the next 20 years compared with the last 30 or 40 years. Meanwhile, the speed with which people come out of agriculture is diminishing. You can see that the labor force, industrial labor force growth got driven by this huge fall in movement out of, a huge decline in the number of people working in subsistence agriculture. There's much less scope in the future, and that's for two reasons. One, the easy pickings have been had. But the second reason is that with demand going up, rising demand for food and to provide resources for the world's population will actually limit the extent to which the world's agricultural proportion of labor will decline. So we end up with, compared with a 115% increase over the last 30 years, over the next 20 years, we only expect an increase in the non-agricultural labor force of 40%. That's a much less dramatic demographic gain. It's slowing down from 2.6% annual growth to 1.8%. The other factor is that as ICT becomes a mature industry, I think we have to assume, although it's the sort of industry that never is completely mature, it's like some teenagers who never grow up, but we could move to a point where returns on investment are significantly lower than in the past. So my theory is that for the next 20 years, the share of labor will edge down a bit more in total, but that will be it, and it will be relatively minor. So there will only be a minor return, a minor growth in profits, and certainly nothing like the gains in profits that we've seen over the last 35 years. So my conclusion from that is that the world's boom market for equities, which has been a very powerful one for the last, 48 years in the British case, that might be coming to an end. We may get some real growth. I'm not predicting a slump, but I'm predicting an end to a process where equity values increase strongly in real terms over the cycle. And the end of the boom is with a whimper, not a bang. We're not suggesting collapse. And this is for two factors. Yields are likely to remain low, but unlikely to fall further significantly on a cyclically adjusted basis. And indeed, they could cyclically rise as we go into the recovery phase of the cycle in quite a lot of economies, even if the demand within which they rise will be lower than in the past as a result of the Chinese savings glut that I dealt with in my lecture last year. And second, the force feeding of labor into the world economy is slowing down dramatically. We're in the middle phase, really, of globalization. The industries are still immature, but they're maturing now. And for the next 20 years, we're just going to see much of the processes that we've seen before operating, but operating much less aggressively. And so some of the spectacular results, the extraordinary rates of growth and so on, are unlikely to be repeated. Now, this is the thing you've all been waiting for, the optimal rate of exploitation. I did all these calculations on a plane flying between Singapore and Dubai, but I think they still hold. I don't think the atmospheric pressure did too much damage. I got interested in the concept of the optimal rate of exploitation when I was in Chicago this summer. For those of you who don't know, Chicago has an amazing art gallery called the Chicago Art Institute, which is one of the really great galleries in the world. It ranks with the Louvre, the Hermitage, and the top London galleries. It even has a good collection of Van Goghs, which is very rare in museums, because Van Gogh's agent was his brother, who was he was worse than useless, and he sold very few works of art. As a result, his permanent collection, still contains a very high proportion of all his paintings, because they never got sold. And that's now the official collection in Amsterdam. So those of you who aren't interested in the brown cafes and the red light districts still have some reason to go to Amsterdam, which is a fantastic Van Gogh museum. Now, if you look at the Chicago Art Institute, the collection was created from Chicago's immense wealth in the period from about 1870 to 1950. And that financed the bedrock of the collection. And you have to ask yourself, why was Chicago wealthy? The reason is that it was the end of the railroad from the south, and where the African Americans, after the Civil War, or what my southern friends call the War Between the States, migrated in search of a better life after they were freed from slavery. Remember, they were freed from slavery, which is obviously a good thing, but they also lost their jobs. And so it wasn't all win-win. So they migrated in search of a better life. And Chicago was the obvious place to go to because people didn't have cars in those days, so very great, particularly poor people. So you traveled by rail, and it was the end of the railway. And it was a great, thriving metropolis already. And it looks to me as if what happened was that the surplus of labor that was available held down wages and enabled the capitalists to make the huge profits that financed the art collections that ended up in the museum. So the capitalists were clearly better off for exploitation, but that isn't the only measure, of course. Just because the capitalists are happy doesn't necessarily mean that exploitation is a good thing. So the question in my mind is, how much worse off were the workers for being exploited? Clearly they were worse off in the short term because they got low wages. But were they worse off in the longer term? Because if an economy grows faster, by and large, wages will grow roughly with the economy. And so you may start off by being exploited, but you may be better off later on. Now, if you're looking at just one city, what tends to happen with faster growth is it doesn't necessarily raise wages. It just means faster migration to the city. And I think that's roughly what happened in the Chicago case. So in the Chicago case, the workers weren't better off for being exploited, although there were a lot more people who went to Chicago as a result of that. But in China, which is doesn't have immigration, really, the same process is going on right now, something very similar to Chicago in the 19th century. And wages and living standards are rising incredibly rapidly. I mean, we've seen wages rising by between 10 and 25% in a single year, while prices are going up 4 or 5%. I mean, we've had wages going up 25%, but that's when prices were going up 28%. So we weren't better off as a result. But the Chinese have had big wage increases and very low price increases, which has meant they're better off. And living standards are rising very rapidly because the low wages that they had initially led to high profits, led to high investment, which financed further growth, and that's pushed up wages. Now, I did some maths using a simple model just to see what are the conditions when low wages make you worse off, and what are the conditions when they don't. And that's in this graph. And the answers are quite interesting. The top point after, if you treat these as years, the top point after 10 years, you get the highest income after 10 years if you start off with 70% of GDP going to the capitalists and 30% going to the worker. So it's actually quite incredible that if you start off being paid 30, in 10 years' time you'll be better off than someone who started off being paid 80 because of the differential implications of investment. And basically between 30 and 70% is a sort of sweet spot. Anything over 70 starts to squeeze profits so much that investment is squeezed and you start eating into the seed corn and you get very little growth and the growth can eventually go negative. So what this is the context that we need to analyze the fall in the wages share that we've seen, because we've seen a fall from about 70% to about 60% in the advanced economies. what I'm arguing here is actually workers could be exploited a lot more, and even they would be better off, let alone the capitalists. So that is my comments on the fact that the labour share has fallen. I still think, actually, everyone would be better off if it was lower still. But clearly, there comes a point where that is not the case. And once the wages share goes below 30%, it's so low that you just stay exploited. The economy grows fast, but all the gains go to the fat capitalists, and you don't gain from that. So, but somewhere in the 30 to 7% range, that's the sweet spot. If you go above 70, profits get too low, and the system cannot reproduce itself, which is essentially what Karl Marx is talking about in his concept of the contradictions of capitalism. Now, we were there in Britain. We got up to about 75% in the mid-70s, and the country pretty well ground to a halt, indeed literally. Remember the three-day week? Some of you look old enough to remember that. Some of you will only have read about it in the history books. The miners' strike, not the 1984 one, but the miners' strikes that they won. Times when the lights were off, when there was no heating because there was no electricity, etc. I mean, these were the interesting days of the 1970s. And they pushed up the wages share, but capitalism pretty well stopped working. But a whole series of factors, of which information technology and globalization are by far the two most important, has allowed capitalism to recover. And although the labor force growth from globalization is still slowing down, there is still enough growth in labor forces worldwide to make a profits collapse over the near future fairly unlikely. If it does happen, it is unlikely to be in the current middle phase of globalization, which I would think will last about 25 years, but maybe in the late stage of globalization, when it has become mature, round about sometime between 2014 and 2050. And after that, the conditions may change. But I think until then, there's going to be enough competition to keep profits high. Now, the other point which the analysis shows is, provided capitalists invest for growth, which Marx did assume and which is called a Caldorian savings function after the same Nicholas Caldor I mentioned earlier, workers who are exploited in Marxist sense, in that they earn low share of income, do better. And Marx assumed that the workers could prevent exploitation eventually through the strike weapon, and that this would be one of the contradictions that would kill capitalism. I'm not so sure. Certainly hasn't been the case recently. The surplus of labour that has coincided with globalisation has actually coincided with a more successful phase of capitalism. So the question I posed at the beginning was Karl Marx always wrong? And the answer is that he's not yet been proved right about the failures of capitalism in most industrialised economies, although the Brits certainly gave him a chance in the 70s. And of course, the majority of communist countries have given up communism as an economic ideology, even if they, as for example in China, keep up its political structures. So Karl Marx didn't quite get it right, but the Brits had a good go at proving him that way. I think his next chance to be proved right is sometime beyond 2050, when the conditions of globalization have matured, and workers will then again be in a position to exploit the capitalists rather than having capitalists exploit them. Now, I've argued that's not great news, because workers do better when they're exploited. And so Marx, who did predict that capitalism had its own contradictions, he could yet be proved correct. However, I have to say, even if capitalism fails, I think the failures of communism, the contradictions of communism, have proved such that it's fairly unlikely we'll go to communist countries if capitalism does fail sometime in the latter part of the 21st century. I think we may go for some rather more mixed solution. So that's the lecture. Marx hasn't yet been proved right. You'll be pleased to know, some of you anyway. The workers have been better off for being exploited. So that's something that should cheer people up at this time of Christmas, when we all need a bit of cheering up. So thank you very much again for attending. Thank you very much for your patience. And as I normally say at the end of my lecture, I notice some of you have looked at your watches, but I have noticed that none of you have tapped the watch to see if it's stopped, which if you're a lecturer is a good sign. Thank you very much indeed. I now take questions.